Good morning and welcome to St. James this morning. I'll turn on my mic. Let's try that again. Good morning and welcome to St. James.
Good morning.
Growing up in the Episcopal Church, we used to call this Bible Sunday. And so I'd like you during the service to see if you can figure out why we call this Bible study. Consider it like a scavenger hunt during the service. And our service begins on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer. Page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Presented herself before before the Lord. Now Eli, the priest, was sitting on the seat beside the doorpost of the temple of the Lord. She was deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. She made this vow, "O Lord of hosts, if only you will look on the misery of your servant and remember me, and not forget your servant, but will give to your servant a male child, then I will set him before you as a Nazarite until the day of his death. He shall drink neither wine nor intoxicants, and no razor shall touch his head." As she continued praying before the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was praying silently. Only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore, Eli thought she was drunk. So Eli said to her, "How long will you make a drunken spectacle of yourself? Put away your wine." But Hannah answered, "No, my lord, I am a woman deeply troubled. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but I have been pouring out my soul before the Lord. Do not regard your servant as a worthless woman, for I have been speaking out of my great anxiety and vexation all this time." Then Eli answered, "Go in peace. The God of Israel grant the petition you have made to him." And she said, "Let your servant find favor in your sight." Then the woman went to her quarters, ate and drank with her husband, and her countenance was sad no longer. They rose early in the morning and worshipped before the Lord. Then they went back to their house at Ramah. Elkanah knew his wife Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. In due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son. She named him Samuel, for she said, "I have asked him of the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm this morning is not a psalm. It is a piece of scripture from 1 Samuel. It's the Song of Hannah, which is a song of praise. It's found in your bulletin, and the congregational responses are in bold. Hannah prayed and said,
"My heart exalts the Lord. My strength is exalted in my mouth.
My mouth derides my enemies, because I rejoice in my victory.
There is no one like the Lord, no one besides you. There is no God like our God."
Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed.
The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble bird are strength.
Those who are full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who are hungry are fat with spoil.
The barren has borne sad, but the she that has made children is a lone one.
The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up.
The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low and also exalts.
He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor.
For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on them he has set the world.
He will guard the feet of his faithful ones, but the wicked shall be cut off in darkness, for not by might does one prevail.
The Lord is heaven, and the earth shall be scattered, and the Most High will thunder in heaven.
The Lord will judge the ends of the earth.
He will give strength to his king, and exalt the high of his anointed.
Lesson from the letter of St. Paul to the Hebrews. Every priest stands day after day at his service, offering again and again the same sacrifices that can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. and since then has been waiting until his enemies would be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also testifies to us, for after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds," he also adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin." Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as you are able. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
As Jesus came out of the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what large stones and what large buildings." Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see these great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down." When he was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Tell us, when will this be? And what will be the sign that all these things are about to be accomplished?" Then Jesus began to say to them, "Beware that no one leads you astray. Many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and they will lead many astray. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, do not be alarmed. This must take place, but the end is still to come. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places. There will be famines. This is but the beginning of the birth pangs." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please pray with me. May the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts always be acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our salvation. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Well, in the Frank family, and maybe perhaps in some of your families, we face a weekly challenge. Is Sunday the first day of the week or the last day of the week? So is Wednesday, November 17th, this Wednesday or next Wednesday? For Franks and maybe others near and far, this ambiguity has caused a number of misunderstandings and even some misengagements over the generations. Of course, always blame your grandparents, right? It works well.
And now we simply try to avoid using the word next before a day of the week, especially on Sundays. Of much more import than this Tuesday versus next Tuesday is the time challenge that involves beginnings and endings. Beginnings and endings pose a challenge in our lives, knowing which is which, and then traversing the territory between them. For we often face endings with fear and anxiety. Face it, we like the security of the status quo, or the proverbial devil we know. Yet endings prove exciting. Exciting when we lift up our hope for a still uncharted future. An uncharted future in which God, working through us, can do more than we can ask or imagine. And a sense of peace starts to cast out fear and anxiety when we acknowledge what was and is, and become curious about what might be. How might our lives become more abundant? And how might we experience and share God's unconditional love? Yet when we start looking for signs of endings and beginnings, we often become fooled. I'll give a simple example. In one church where I served as interim, I had a Sunday late morning flight to catch to attend a church meeting that started late on Sunday afternoon in Baltimore. So a Lutheran friend of mine, who I went to seminary with, said, "I'll help out. I'll preach and preside at the second service so you can just go to the airport and not worry about catching your plane." Seemed pretty easy to me. Upon my return, I realized that the parish thought my friend Libby was auditioning or doing a tryout to become the new rector. Well, let's face it, we all have our stories of missed or misinterpreted signs. Today's gospel reading in Mark comes from the tradition of apocalyptic literature. Personally, when I hear the word apocalyptic, I'm usually relieved that someone else is saying it. Once past the tongue twister, I immediately think the end. Perhaps as in the zombie apocalypse, or the seven signs of the apocalypse. You remember, we'll be struck by deadly plagues, famines, and earthquakes. The sky will turn dark and oceans will turn to blood. And the Antichrist will emerge to fight the final battle between good and evil. But there's another take on this. The word apocalypse itself means uncovering or revelation. The subject of this uncovering is end times or last things. Our human focus, like the four disciples, is on what are the events or signs or woes that will precede the end or show that the end is coming. We tend to forget that the so-called end is actually the fulfillment of God's plan, a plan foretold in Scripture, which is a new beginning, the kingdom of God, a beginning that is already starting to happen all around us. The image we see today in Mark's gospel is one of giving birth. Birth pangs, intense, deep suffering, that signify the beginning of new life, the emergence of new creation. This image captures Mark's theme of discipleship. It's part and parcel of the Markan journey. From Advent 1 to today, as we've read many of excerpts and stories from Mark's scripture, from the gospel, a gospel sometimes called Stark Mark, which never sugarcoats his message. His clear message, there is a cost to discipleship. So if you haven't lost something, if you're not forced outside of your comfort zone, if you haven't taken a risk, sorry, it's not discipleship. To reach Easter, and the Easter of our lives, one has to touch the cross. One has to live through Good Friday. Where's the good news? Well, William Sloane Coffin explains it in sort of this adage, God is maximum security and minimum protection. In other words, God doesn't protect us from suffering, but God is with us to support us through that suffering. We can count on God to fulfill the promise to always be with us. So where's the beef? As disciples of Christ, as servants of the Lord and each other, let's stop looking for signs and simply get ready and serve. At St. Andrew's Barberton at one time, they used a dismissal, a special response to the dismissal. So the faithful there would respond to the invitation to go in peace, to love and serve the Lord with, let's do it. Which is to say, borrowing from the letter to the Hebrews, let's provoke and encourage each other to love and do good deeds. As disciples, let's take the risk of discipleship, of allowing ourselves to be changed, to be transformed, relying on God's promise not to protect us, but to support us in all our efforts. All our efforts to love God, love our neighbor, and change the world. One way you might respond this week involves prayerful consideration of a letter that God willing and the U.S. Postal Service willing, you'll receive this week from St. James. Yes, it's the stewardship letter. I hope you will prayerfully consider a commitment of time, talent, and treasure. A commitment that takes you a bit out of your comfort zone. A commitment that comes not from that which is left over of your time, talent, and treasure, but from the first fruits of the gifts that God has bestowed upon you. I pray that you will consider a commitment that will not only maintain our brick and mortar, which is so important for worship, fellowship, fun, formation, and ministry, but also a commitment that provides a springboard to the ministry which God is calling us to do beyond our walls as well as our comfort zones. Yes, just as one day we will return to the dust, so also will our buildings. They too one day will be a heap of rubble. But the time in between, now, matters. We live in a world focused not only on those with whom we worship, but those whom our worship nourishes us and supports us as we do ministry with and for others. I pray that in the coming year, not just stewardship season, we will challenge ourselves to shed our fears and step out in faith, living in the just do it present, not in the past, and not in looking at the uncertainty of the future. Barbara Brown Taylor captures this and so many other things so well. She writes, "Live a caught-up life, not a put-off life, so that wherever you are ready for God, for whatever happens next. Not afraid, but wide awake. Jesus will come again, we don't know when. So we live in faith and hope. We live with our eyes peeled to discover where it is that God is at work, so we can get busy offering our hands to do God's work, ever watching for the Lord who never tires of coming." Amen. Our service continues with the Nicene Creed, which is found on page 358. Please stand as you are able. We reaffirm our faith, saying, "We believe in one God,
Father of the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and as a saved man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. In accordance with the scriptures, he is ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen."
Prayers of the People this week are Form 3, page 387, through Book of Common Prayer. We will pray responsibly. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That we may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the name. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let the light perpetual shine upon them.
May we praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others. All those on our prayer list, parishioners, friends and family, and all those who serve as first responders and armed forces. We offer thanks for the blessings you have given to us, for the birthdays of Tom, Val, Mary Lynn, Connor, Anne, and the 97th birthday of Howard McCain, and also for the anniversary of Bill and Heidi.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of thy kingdom, and grant that we, thy servants who now live by faith, may with joy behold thy Son at his coming in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. And now let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess our sins against you, by thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand as you are able. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Thank you. Prayer 80. It's found on page 361. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And in the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity via the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Thank you.
post-communion prayer is found on page 365. Page 365. Let us pray. Eternal God,
Heavenly Father, we have graciously accepted us as the living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and we have professed the Spirit of your food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and bring us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Please be seated. So did anyone figure out why today is Bible Sunday? Take a look at the collect.
Yes.
Yes. There you go. Yep. So
turn your mic on.
Fair enough. So one announcement. This coming Saturday, November 20th. We'll just use November 20th. At 7 p.m. is Pie Night at Baker Square. 7 p.m. Dutch treat, and it's just a fun time to get together in a safe way and have a little bit of fun as we head into a season of Thanksgiving. As I mentioned, you will, yes?
Can I add just one thing to that?
Sure.
I just want to make you aware that there's limited seating, especially because of COVID. So it's really important that you sign up either online on Facebook page, there's a sign up sheet downstairs, so just let me know. Because I think when you get there and they're not getting close to the city. So please sign up so we know you're coming and we have our seats for everybody. Thank you.
Well, if the weather's good, there's always a parking lot. I know, we're getting to the season, that's not the case. Just a reminder that there's coffee hour downstairs after this service, and I do have my box for you to put in questions you have for me as the interim, and I'll take a few. There's those. Right now, there are only two or three questions in the box. I didn't pre-read them, so I don't know what they are, but feel free to do that, and we'll just have a little fun with it and draw those out. But it's an opportunity for everyone to start to get to know me a little bit better. And I believe we have some anniversaries and birthdays, and we'll start with the anniversary, Bill and Heidi. So I have a little Celtic anniversary prayer that I'd like to share. The joy of that day be in your face, the joy that made you grow in grace. The joy of memory be yours today, the joy of growth along the way. May you be joy to all who meet you, God's angels be always there to greet you. The circle of Christ around your neck, that day in heaven may you ne'er forget. On this anniversary, God give you the best of memories. Christ give you pardon for failings. Spirit give you fruits of friendship. Amen. And a little round of applause. And let's see, anyone, our birthday, anyone have a birthday who's here? Yes, excellent. If you'd like to, page 830 in the Book of Common Prayer, and we will use prayer 51. And we'll make it plural, even though we have those, we only have one person here, but we have others we're praying for in the parish. So together we pray. Watch over thy children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may thy peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus
Christ.
Stand for the, as you are able, for the blessing. Life is short, and we do not have much time to gladden the hearts of those who journey the way with us. So be swift to love, make haste to be kind. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain among you this day and forevermore.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.